Good morning. How's everybody this morning? All right, I invite you guys to stand up. We're going to sing Your Love Awakens.
You came and broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You called. You called me out of the grave. You called me into the light. You called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me.
Feel the darkness.
Feel the darkness shaking. All the dead are coming back to life. I'm back to life. Hear the song awaken. All creation sing, oh, we're alive. Cause you're alive. You called me. You called me out of the grave. You called me into the light. You called my name and then my heart came alive. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me.
What a love.
Oh, what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out. We're alive. Cause you're alive. Oh, what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive. Let's declare our church. What a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive. Cause you're alive. Oh, what a love we found. Death can't hold us down. We shout it out, we're alive. Cause you're alive. Oh, your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. You awaken me, Lord. You awaken me.
Come on, just continue your love.
Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens.
Come on, let it be a love cry. Come on.
Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me. Your love is greater. Your love is stronger. Your love awakens, awakens, awakens me.
Give the Lord a hand of praise. Come on, He's worthy. He's worthy of it all. I've seen.
But I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like. But I've heard the tender whispers of love in the dead of night. And you tell me that you're pleasing, that I'm never alone. You're a cook of fun, so you are, so you are, so you are, and I'm loved by you, so I am, so I am.
You're good.
I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, because you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us.
Come on, church, you sing.
You're a good, good father. You're a good, good
love so.
Oh,
It's who I am. It's who I am. Come on, let's sing it out. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. Too. Just the voices. You're perfect. Come on, despite the circumstances. You are perfect. My heart is yours, my heart is yours, take it all, my life in your hands, my heart is voices.
Sing it out, church.
And I will never love and trust you.
Let's do it again. All to Jesus, I surrender. Come on, everything for Jesus today. All to Jesus.
All to Jesus, I surrender. All to you, I freely give. I will ever love and trust you in your presence.
Yes. I will. Come on, church. We surrender everything to you, Jesus.
I will never love and trust you.
Awesome, awesome, awesome. Well, I'm glad all of you are here today. My name is Rob. Yeah, give Jesus a hand. Give Jesus a hand. My name is Rob, and I'm the lead pastor here at Celebration Church. Please be seated this morning. Thank you, Carlitos. I call him Carlitos still. He's Carlitos, Poquitos, Taquitos. No, I love Carlos, man. Thank you, Carlos, for so much leading us. Right, give Carlos and the worship team a hand this morning. Thank you so much. Amen. I remember meeting Carlos about 6 or 7 years ago, and he was, I guess, Carlitos Jr. then, and now he's kind of moved up a little bit. But glad he's leading us this morning. Thank you so much for your heart for Jesus. If you're a guest with us this morning, we want to welcome you, give you a special welcome. Real quickly, just so you're kind of in the loop, this is the time that our kids ages 6 through 10, they break to go to what we call Kids Celebrate. If you're a guest this morning and you have a child that you would love to go to Kids Celebrate, all you simply have to do, if they didn't check you in when you first came in today, all you have to do is go right back there, and they will make sure that you get checked in. We also have nursery available. Miss Corey, Miss Betsy, and her team will make sure that you guys get checked in this morning. And all they're going to do is continue to learn about Jesus back there at more at their level. But I promise you, it's they're going to have a good time. And if you're a guest with us this morning, you say, well, I want them to check out this Kids Celebrate, but I want to check it out too. You're more than welcome to go back there with them. Now, us the big kids, if you will, are going to stay in here this morning, and we're going to continue to learn about Jesus. But let me do this before I get started. They're going to turn this middle light on for me here in just a second. But as we do that, just right there, right by your seat, you don't have to get up and walk around, just to your left, to your right, in front of you, back, just shake someone's hand, tell them you're glad. And if you have to get up, that's fine.
Thank you.
Good morning. How's everybody this morning? All right, I invite you guys to stand up. We're going to sing Your Love Awakens. You came and broke them down. You broke them down. There were chains around us. By your grace we are no longer bound. No longer bound. You called. You called me out of the grave. You called me into the light. You called my name in.
Something fun. Okay. We are at 13,500. Okay. That's as of this morning. There may be some other coming in. Okay. Yeah. Give Jesus a hand. For our guests or our visitors, we have actually outgrown this space, and it's become really hard for us to kind of do what we need to do here, so we're just believing that God is giving us a new property. We've been scoping that out. We went last week to pray over it again, and we're just believing whatever God wants to do. Let me just be very clear. We do not adopt the philosophy here and build it and they will come, because that's not the gospel. Okay? So we're not looking for a bigger building to look at us and building to come. We're looking at it as a way to disciple and equip more people to go and tell and make. See the difference? Okay? So I want to make sure that we fully understand that this morning, that this is about Jesus, and that we want to make sure that we reach our city. There's 20,000 people in this area that either A, don't believe in God, don't have a church home, are far away from God, right? Or hurt, angry, whatever. And here's what I love about Jesus is he's not intimidated by any of it. Isn't that awesome? We may be intimidated by it, but Jesus isn't, okay? And so we want to make sure that we get Jesus out to as many people as possible. So here's what I want to do. We're going to dive into our teaching time this morning, but I want to pray for us real quickly, and then we're going to dive in, and we are starting a brand new series today about grace, okay? And maybe you've heard about grace. Maybe you've grown up in church, and you've heard about grace. But here's the thing that I have found with most believers and non-believers is we really don't understand what it really means. It's something that we sing a lot about. It's something that we've heard our whole lives. It sounds really good, right? Especially in this culture. I want to go to a church where there's a lot of grace, right? And the reality is we don't really understand what it means biblically. So over the next 3 weeks, we're going to look at it today. We're going to take a few minutes and we're going to define it, okay? Next week, we're going to talk about why we need grace. See, you can't appreciate the good news until you understand the bad news. So next week, we're going to look at the bad news, but still come, right? Still come, because we're going to have some good donuts and juice and all that kind of stuff, okay? All right? And then the following week, the third week, we're going to talk about how do I live in grace? How does grace empower me? How does the believer live in grace and be enabled and empowered by grace? Let's pray. Father, we love you today. Here's what I pray, Jesus, that we make it all about you from start to finish and in between. I pray for Alex, God, as he's getting ready to get baptized here shortly, that you would just continue to move in his heart, God, and you would just move him closer to you. I pray for every church. I pray for the Methodist, the Baptist, the Pentecostals, the Charismatics, the Presbyterians, the Episcopalians, I can't even say it this morning. God, I pray for every church in this region that Jesus would invade every space and that every preacher would preach the gospel, the good news, and that Jesus, you would be lifted up. You would be lifted up, God. We love you and we thank you. Illuminate this word to us this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Listen, man, we pray for every church around here, because here's the thing. The kingdom of God is not a competition. Amen. We pray that God will use anyone in any place for the further the gospel. I will say this. If you are a guest with us today, you go, man, boy, those guys really like to shout and scream and dance a little bit or whatever. That's why we called ourselves Celebration Church. It'd kind of be weird if you came in here to a celebration church and we were just kind of like, right? We just love to celebrate Jesus because we're excited. Here's the thing. 20 years ago, he saved me literally from the pits of hell. And woe unto me if I don't praise him, because he'll raise up the rocks to do it if I don't do it. He'll raise up these chairs. Man, he'll even raise up these connection cards to do it. Amen? God's going to get his praise. He's going to get his worship because he's worthy of all of it. So we're going to dive in this morning to grace. The other thing you should have received in your worship guide is notes that look just like these. Okay? We would love for you to follow along with us today. If you did not get a copy of these notes, I'm going to ask our dream teamers and our leaders to look around. If you need to raise your hand and get a copy, we'll make sure you get a copy here within a few minutes, okay? So let's make sure all of our guests and visitors have one, especially that they have one as well, okay? So grace is greater. Now, I had a little question mark there, but I thought that was probably a little too much. But the reality is, okay, and Matt didn't like my original arrow, but that's okay. This made the final draft here, right? That's what I love about our associate pastors and our other pastors, because they'll just tell you the truth. He was like, he didn't even look at it very long. He just went, no, I don't like it. Okay? But what I wanted to do here is I wanted you to understand by week three that grace is greater than anything you're facing today. Right? Here's why. Because the one that's giving the grace, the one who is grace, it's his character, if you will, is greater than any situation or circumstance you're in today. Okay? So today what I want to do is I want to talk to you about grace. So let's look at it real quickly. And grace in its simplest form, right? We've heard of this, God's unmerited favor, right? Right? You ever heard that before? If you grew up around church, even if you didn't, right? God's unmerited favor. And why that is true, or maybe you've heard the acronym, and I'll be honest with you, I'm not trying to offend you if you're really religious today. I just don't do the cheesy Christian acronym thing, okay? But there's one that says God's riches at Christ's expense. I'm not against that. We've heard that, but it's even more than that, okay? So let me tell you something. Grace is not merely unmerited favor. It is favor bestowed on sinners who deserve wrath. Now, that's not a popular word to say in the church, right? But deserve wrath and who are condemned. Okay? I'm going to show you in the gospel, okay? Now, you're not supposed to use those two words if you're trying to grow a church, but we love people enough to speak the truth in love today. Okay? And once again, we can't understand what grace really is unless we hear the bad news part of it. Okay? So Ephesians 2:3, they're going to put it on the screen for us. If you have a copy of God's Word, you're more than welcome to open it up. We also have a copy of God's Word sporadically placed throughout the worship center. It says this, and this is Paul writing. If you've never read Ephesians chapter 2, okay? If you've never read this passage of Scripture, this chapter, I recommend that you go read it. Okay, it's very life-transforming. It says this, among whom we all once lived in the passions of our flesh. Okay, that's all of us, right? If you're a believer today, this used to be you. Carrying out the desires of the body and the mind, and I love this part, and by nature are children of wrath. Let me explain something to you. Now, I don't want to get overly academic, but I need to explain this to you. See this cross right here? The man who was on this cross 2,000 years ago absorbed the righteous wrath of God on your behalf and on my behalf. Okay? It wasn't diverted because God in his holy character had to have a perfect sacrifice. He absorbed. We were children of God wrath. If you are not a believer today, listen, I love you. There's tons of grace in this room, but God's wrath is directed. But it can be absorbed the cross of Christ. Okay? Now, I know that's not popular, but we got to be real here for a minute, okay? Like the rest of mankind. Paul just pretty much says it, right? All of us were children of wrath. Let me go through Romans 5:18 real quickly, okay? Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation for all men, if you didn't grow up around church, there was this guy named Adam and there was this girl named Eve. Right? They were the first man and woman ever created. Unfortunately, they fell. They sinned against God. And because of one trespass, what he's likening here is Paul is arguing in Romans 5 about one man. He's using Adam, and then he's using another man. That's Jesus. Okay? Therefore, as one trespass led to condemnation, what does condemnation mean? It means that judgment is on you. Right? Okay? For all men. How many men? All men. Well, I'm a good man. All men. I've served as a deacon for 20 years. All men. I give money to the poor. All men. I'm very religious. All men. I'm very spiritual. All men. Okay? Apart from the perfect work of Christ, the condemnation and the wrath cannot be absorbed or taken care of. The penalty cannot be paid. Okay? So one act of righteousness, referring to Jesus, leads to justification. And once again, I don't have time to get into justification. We've talked about it a lot around here. Justification is just a big fancy word to this. And you don't have to raise your hand on this. but I'm pretty for sure all of us have been to court at one time or another. Some of us maybe for some more serious things than others. But here's the thing. Here's what justification means. If I was to go into court today because I had 20 speeding tickets, okay, I don't, but if I did, right, I do like to drive fast, but by the grace of God, he's had a lot of grace on me, okay? So you can pray for me on that one, all right? But if I had 20 speeding tickets and I went in to this court today, how many people know that I would be guilty, that I'm condemned? Because I committed the acts, right? But it would be like going into the court of law today and the judge taking his son, and I'm using a very layman's analogy here, okay, and saying my son is going to pay the price for these tickets and is going to serve the time for these tickets. And my gavel's going down, and today it's all been made right. That's what justification means in God's court of law, that we were children of wrath, that we were condemned, that we were not righteous, that we've all fallen short of the glory of God. And when we believe, notice I didn't say when we did 10 things to be a Christian. When we believe, notice I didn't say it's about being religious or doing a whole bunch of right things. When we believe in the perfect work of the cross, John 19:30, it is finished. We stand in God's court of law, and the gavel goes down and says, you have been made right. Isn't that good? Here's the cool thing today. That can happen to you right now. If you do not know Jesus today, here's what I pray, that you would say, I want to receive that type of grace. Right? That's what justification means. It's a legal term in the language of the New Testament. And I love this, in life for all men. Right? So I want to give you a definition of grace by a guy who's more smarter in his pinky than I'll ever be in 10 lifetimes. His name is J.I. Packer. Okay? Some of you know who he is. He's just a great man of God, awesome theologian. And it says, in the New Testament, grace means God's, I love this, love in action. See, it's Romans 5:8 that God demonstrates his love. Aren't you glad, right? Ladies, let me speak to you for a minute. Aren't you glad that God is not someone who says he loves you but never shows it? Right? Amen. Amen. Right? All right. Right, I've been told that too. Why don't you show me, baby? All right. And then I got real spiritual, so I don't do that anymore. All right. Towards men who merited, right? It's God's love in action towards men who merited the opposite of love. You didn't earn love. I didn't merit love. We didn't warrant love. Our lives, our sinfulness, our depravity, these insidious hearts merited judgment and wrath in light of a righteous, holy God. Right? Grace means God, I love this, moving heaven and earth to save sinners who could not lift a finger. Jay and I, Packer, and I kind of talk the same way. Right? To save themselves. There was nothing that you could do in your own strength or power to merit this type of love and grace and mercy. Amen? Okay? So I want you to let that sink in. I want you to meditate on that. I want you to marinate it, right? I don't know why I'm thinking a big steak, man. Just marinate it this morning. You be that big steak in whatever seasoning and marinate in this grace today, right? You marinate as we go through the message. So grace explained, right? Number one is grace is unmerited, right? Right? Grace is an unmerited and undeserved gift. Right? It's unmerited and is an undeserved gift. You should have had some spaces in there to fill it in. Right? Grace is an unmerited and undeserved gift. See, here's what happens. When we first become born again, don't we really believe this? But then after 20 years of being religious, we lose sight of this. I don't care if you've been serving God for 30 years or you give your life to Jesus today, you still don't deserve it and you didn't merit it. Okay? It's all because of Jesus. Jesus didn't say in John 19:30, it is finished, but you got to do 10 religious things. Right? He said, it is finished. 2 Timothy 1:9 says this, okay? Says this, that for he delivered us and saved us, and I'm using the Amplified version, I have it there in your notes, and called us with a holy calling. Right? That just means a calling that's lead to a consecrated life, a life that's we set apart for Jesus, a life of purpose, not because of our works, right? Not because of anything that we've done, not because of our works, but because, right, or any personal merit. We could do nothing to earn this, is what it says in parentheses, but because of his own purpose and grace. And in parentheses, it says his amazing undeserved favor, right, which was granted to us in Christ Jesus before the world began. One commentator put it this way. He says, the principle of grace is as fundamental to Christianity as that of justice is to the law or love is to marriage. Christianity cannot be understood, I love this, apart from an adequate grasp of grace. Okay? In other words, the doctrine of grace distinguishes the Christian faith from any other, from every other religion or faith in the world, because every other religion or faith in the world has a performance-based dynamic attached to it. We serve a God in his initiating love that came to us, that pursued us, and because of that pursuit, he illuminated in our hearts, right, Jesus, right? You understand that? Okay? So it's different than any other religion. Some of you may have heard of what we call the Protestant Reformation. They believed in this so much that they understood the importance of God's grace, right, to the Bible's teaching on salvation, that one of their five solas, right, was sola gratia, which just means by grace alone, right? Here's what it means right here on the screen. By grace alone is simply acknowledging, I love this, that the Bible teaches that the totality of our salvation is a gift of grace from God, right? And if you don't know much about the Protestant Reformation, at that time, the church, right, would have been the Catholic Church, right, the predominant church at the time, was actually abusing what they call indulgences or charging people to pay for penance. In other words, the more that you would pay for something, right, the better blessing, the more you could be forgiven, right? And people like Martin Luther and William Tyndale and those sparked this Reformation. And they said by Christ alone, by faith alone, right, by grace alone, and so on. I think we need to return to this today. Okay? Can I be very clear? We have to be careful that we do not abuse grace, and we'll talk about this more in the next couple of weeks. We're not talking about the grace that gives us the license to do whatever the heck we want to do, right? Because that makes a mockery of the cross. But we're not also talking about trying to earn grace, which makes us a legalist. See, Jesus plus something else never works. Okay? It just doesn't. We see it in the Gospels. We've seen it throughout church history. Whenever we add anything besides Jesus to this, right, then we're polluting it, okay? So here's the thing. In the Hebrew, right, we don't see much about grace in the Old Testament, but in the Hebrew, the word is pronounced, it's almost like pain. I think of like, and I have underwear in my mind just because we were talking about earlier, the baptism, but it's pronounced, it says chin. If you take the C off, it's actually with just the H, but you think it would be pronounced hen, like we'd say in the South, right? But it's actually hang. Right? And what it means in the old Testament, right? Favor. I mean, if you want to say hand, you can, but, right? Favor, pleasant, precious, well-favored, right? In the Greek, in the language of the New Testament, right, we see it predominantly in Paul's epistles, right? And here's what it means, right? And it's the word charis. You got to say it with like a loogie in your throat. I hate to be gross. I'm sorry, but charis, right? Right? Or we say in the South, Harry's, right? Right? Not Clarice, like Signs of the Lands, but Harris, right? Harris. And it just means favor, graciousness, and gift. Now, why am I sharing this with you? Because how you view God, right, will ultimately, in his grace, will ultimately determine your understanding of yourself and your salvation. Okay? It will ultimately determine the understanding of yourself. And the more accurately that we can define it, listen, this is very important, the more we can live by it. See, I do believe that grace experienced is better than grace explained, right? And we're going to see that in week 3. However, we can't experience it if we never explain it and define it. It's called spirit and in truth. Spirit and in truth. Amen? Okay? So it's an undeserved gift. Bob Utley says it this way, and I think we have it in the computer. He says, grace is the unsought, unbought activity of God in Jesus Christ. Right? I love that. I love that. Right? In other words, we didn't seek it. We couldn't buy it. We couldn't merit it. We couldn't purchase it. It's all because of Jesus. Ephesians 2, 8 and 9, there on your notes, it says this, for it is by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. Right? I don't know if you've ever did this in school, and I actually meant to bring a marker today, and I forgot. Okay? But you see this white sheet of paper we used to have, our teacher, she would put a little black dot on there, and she would say, that one little black dot pollutes this whole paper. Okay? I don't know if anybody's ever used that as an example or as an analogy. Whenever you add even one dot of merit to grace, it's no longer grace. Okay? That's why Paul writes to the church of Ephesus and to us that is a gift. The faith you have is a gift. The grace you have is a gift. Salvation is a gift. And whenever we add any ounce, a little drop of works to it, okay, it stops becoming grace. Well, then you may be saying to the Christian that's here today, well, Rob, I thought we're supposed to do good things and whatever. Yes, you're supposed to work from your salvation, not work for your salvation. Work from your salvation, which means when I work from my salvation, it's a heart that's been supernaturally transformed by the grace of God through the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense? Okay. Number two, grace is free, right? We've heard this one, but I love this, but it's not cheap. It is free. The gospel's free. Jesus even told his disciples, freely have I given to you. You go freely give. It's free, but it cost someone their life 2,000 years ago, and they suffered the most gruesome death that you could ever suffer. Here's the kicker. For people that were his worst enemies. So can I put it to you? And I know I don't want to be too graphic here. We get a little PG-13 sometimes. And my wife gets on to me. She'll talk to me at the house. You know, you don't say panties in a wad and things like that. You know, don't, you know. She gets on. And if you're a guest today, I'm not trying to offend you. Here's the thing. Here's the thing. We just talk real around here. You don't need to hear my Christianese this morning. You need God to meet you right in the middle of your mess today. In your circumstance, in your situation. So I'm going to be real with you. But I'm getting better. I've grown a lot in 3 years. And I'm getting better. Okay? I'm going to start saying underwear or something like that. Okay? But here's the thing. Here's the thing that I want you to see, is God sends his only son. So all of us that have kids, think about it this morning. I'll be careful because I know we have kids in here. But think about it, if you gave up your only son, I want you to think about this right now. And it may be hard for some of you because you're really spiritual and don't have any enemies. I know that. But if you could just pretend with me today, that'd be great, okay? But think of your worst enemy right now, right? Like some of you just got a mean look, right? And imagine giving up your only child to save that person. Now, as a parent, what does that do to you if you're a parent today? Right? It kind of makes you a little angry, doesn't it? Like, I would never do that. But that's in essence what God did with his son. That he died for wicked and depraved sinners like you and me. He gave up his own son. So grace is free. But it's not cheap. Amen? Grace is free, but it's not cheap, right? Here's the thing. I believe, the reason I put this on here is because I believe for us to truly value this grace, right, I think it's important to know how much it costs. Would you agree with me, right, that if you had a $50,000 car out here and it got keyed versus if you had a 1978 Pinto and it got keyed, would you be more upset at the $50,000 car? Why? Because of how much it costs. This is the value. See, I think in the church today, we don't understand the value in the infinite worth of this grace. See? And so before we can appropriate and understand it, we need to truly value it. The greater the cost, the more it's cherished. Now, here's the other thing that you need to know. Because of God's holy character, he couldn't just overlook sin. See, I think this is a problem we have in the American church too, is God just didn't say, poof, sin is gone. Because God's holy character demands justice. So justice had to be served 2,000 years ago, and all of his righteous wrath, all of the wrath that you and I deserved, was poured out on his only son. The perfect Lamb of God, who now reigns forevermore. Amen? You see? Because of his holy character, he couldn't just do away with the sin, but he had to reconcile the sinner, the sinners, to himself. This is done through the atoning death of Jesus Christ. You've heard the big word of atonement. I don't want to speak too much Christianese this morning, but all it simply means is at one man. That through the perfect sacrifice that we can be reconciled and made one with Jesus today. Listen, if you don't know Jesus right now in your heart, you can scream out, I want to know this grace. And he will save you. You just scream out, I make a horrible king. I make a horrible king, God. Here are the keys to the kingdom, and I give them to you today. Right? See, God wasn't going to violate his own holiness in order to save the ones that he loves. Did you hear that? God wasn't going to violate his own holiness. There had to be a perfect sacrifice in place, right? Here's the other thing that I want you to see. The grace is free, but to the believer, listen, believer, if you're a believer today, come in close on this one. It's not cheap to you either, because it demands our life. So Jesus said in Luke 9:23, we hear it quoted all the time, if any man will follow me, what? And take up his cross and let him deny himself. The grace is free. It wasn't cheap. It cost. But it also demands our lives as well. Okay? And I love you enough to tell you that it demands our life. Right? We look here on Romans 3:24. Right? This is the NIRV version. It says, the free gift of God's grace makes us right with him. What makes us right? The free gift of God's grace. Christ Jesus paid the price to set us free, right? God, he paid the bill, in other words. Galatians 3:13 from the Amplified Version says this, Christ purchased our freedom, right? What were we a slave to? Sin, ourselves, right? But he purchased our freedom, right, and redeemed us from the curse of the law and its condemnation by becoming a curse for us, for it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs, all right, who hangs crucified on a tree or the cross. Okay, here's what I want you to understand. I've heard it said many, many times that the Old Testament is law and the New Testament is grace. That's not completely accurate, because the Old Testament shows grace. How do I know that? Well, let me give you one person. How many people have heard the guy David in the Old Testament, right? You know, we used to sing this song in church, and I grew up in this crazy charismatic church where we break dance for Jesus and all that kind of stuff, you know, and it was great. And we used to sing this song, when the Spirit of the Lord moves in my heart, I will sing like David sang, right? And it, okay, we'll move on from there. Then I thought maybe there were some other people that had sang that song. Nor are the only ones, evidently, okay? And we would, when the Spirit of the Lord moves in my heart, we will dance like David. And, I mean, you would really sweat off like 1,000 calories, man, doing this whole song, right? The point I'm trying to make is we sang about David. David loved the Lord. The Bible says he was a man after his own heart. But do you know, not only did he commit adultery, but he tried to hide it, right? But yet he was a man after God's own heart. If the Old Testament was all about law, then why did God show grace? And guess who Jesus' lineage is, right? Back through the line of David. You see? So don't ever take it that way. If somebody's told you that, or you're saying that yourself, the Old Testament isn't all about law. It shows God's grace. Okay? So we can't just discontinue the Old Testament and not understand that it's all about grace. And I can go on and on and on. We can talk about other in the Bible. But number three is grace is epitomized in a person. I just wanted to use that word epitomize today. It sounded real spiritual and smart, so I thought I'd throw it on the screen. It just really means this, that it's personified. The perfect example that you could see of grace is in a person. Here's the point that I want to make. This is the reason I put this in today's teaching, because I hear people say that grace is a person. Well, that's partially true, right? You could say grace is a person. His name is Jesus, but I think it's better in the language of the New Testament, and because it's used, I think it's better to say that it's epitomized in the cross of Calvary, in a person named Jesus Christ, through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. Right? Here's the reason I wanted to tell you that today. It's because what I want you to understand, it's not some abstract concept or some, just boring, dead thing, that grace is alive. It's a working, active principle in our lives, and we're going to talk about that in a couple of weeks, right? This is what the Scripture says. In John 1:14, it says, the Word, this is speaking of Jesus. If you didn't grow up in church, the Word right here is speaking of Jesus, right? The Logos, right? The Word became flesh. Jesus left divine glory. If you have a pen and you want to make a note, write Philippians chapter 2 next to that, and you can go read about what happened, right? The Word became flesh and made his dwelling. He tabernacled among us, is what the language of the New Testament is meaning there. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. See, here's the problem. In this world today, in this culture, we all want grace, but we don't want to hear the truth. And the reason we don't want to hear the truth is because we all make up our own versions of the truth. That's the culture we live in, right? And then we wonder why we're in the situation that we're in, because our version of the truth will never live up to his version of the truth. Because his is absolute. Amen? Right? So Jesus is overflowing. That's what this language means. He's overflowing with grace. Right? He's overflowing with grace. John 5:17 in the ESV, God's favorite version, says, for if because of one man's trespass, death reigned through that one man, that once again, we're back to Adam again, right? Adam, if you don't know much about the Scripture, much more will those receive the abundance. Man, underline that word abundance. There's not just grace, there's an abundance. Has anyone ever received an abundance of something? Right? One place says that he's lavished on us. In other words, he's like super soaking us with grace today. You ever seen a super soaker? Two people? Okay, great. Well, the super soaker is this thing we make in America. It's a big water gun. And you put a lot of water in it, and you can soak people down, and you can just destroy people with it. It's awesome. Okay? The Holy Spirit today, in Christ, because of the Father, is super soaking us with grace today. Right? Abundance of grace. Oh, we can't get away from this. And the free gift of righteousness reign in life through one man, Jesus Christ. Grace is epitomized in a person, and he's the only God-man to ever live and that will ever live. He was 100% God and 100% man. That's a message for another day, okay? He's the only God-man, right? Number four, grace, and I kind of got off track on this one because it didn't really kind of go with my message, but I just couldn't resist. Grace is inexhaustible. I really probably should have saved this for week two or three, but man, I just started weeping and crying and just loving God that his grace is inexhaustible. What do I mean by that, Rob? What do you mean? Well, in other words, it's limitless. It's infinite. It's eternal. It's endless. See, Satan wants you, listen, even if you're not a believer today, he wants you to focus on your weaknesses, your frailty, your insecurities. And as a believer, how many of you know that he likes to throw those up every once in a while, right? But the reality is, even if you have fallen, right, even if you're jacked up, if you will, even if you have fallen way short, the Scripture already tells us that we've fallen way short, that we've missed the mark, right? But his grace is not just a one-time event. It's an active working principle in the life of the believer every day, and every day you can wake up and dwell and draw from this infinite well of grace. Right? When I was a kid, we kind of grew up in the ghetto. My mom was a single mom, okay, and we used to go to little water spigots in the summertime, and we would turn them on, and, right? We'd cut a drink, right? Imagine just an abundance of grace pouring on you today. And imagine that spigot of grace never running dry. Why? Because the one who's giving the grace is infinite. The one who's giving the grace is limitless. The one who's giving the grace is self-sustaining.
I want to put it to you this way, real quickly, and I got this quote that I want to share with you. This is one of my favorite pastors. His name is Matt Chandler, and then we'll read the scriptures. And it says this: God does not regret saving you. I love this. There is no sin which you commit which is beyond the cross of Christ. Grace is inexhaustible. Okay? Now, some of you are reading that and kind of, it's because you don't fully understand grace. It's inexhaustible, right? He paid for it. Listen to Lamentations 3:22. You guys didn't know I was going to pull up the Lamentations today, did you? Some of you are like, is that in the Bible? It is. All right? The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases, right? His mercies never come to an end. Isn't that good? They are new every morning. How many people have experienced that newness in the morning, right? Great is your faithfulness. His grace is faithful when you're faithless and when you're unfaithful. His grace pursues you. Right? He's so good. It's inexhaustible. Number two, Isaiah 40:28 from the New Living Translation. Have you ever heard, have you ever understood, the Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of all heaven and earth. He never grows weak or weary. He doesn't need Energizer batteries. Right? You ever seen that commercial? The Lord will never, ever, ever, the supply of grace will never dry up because the Lord goes, oh, whew. Yep, I hate the grace limit today. I may need some angels' help. Moses, can you come help me? Lunchtime. Right? He never grows weak or weary, right? So here's why that's important. You don't ever have to worry about him letting you down when it comes to the grace thing. Okay. He upholds you. He sustains you. No one, I love this, can measure the depths of his understanding. I love this. People try to explain him. They can't. People try to put him in a box. They can't. He's limitless. Right? He's infinite. He's inexhaustible. His grace is inexhaustible. I love that, don't you? He's inexhaustible. Number five, grace has a purpose. Right? Can I just be honest with you? There's only so much we can do in about 30, 45 minutes here on Sunday mornings. Can I encourage you? I still got some things I want to share with you, but I forgot to say this in the beginning. At Celebration Church, we never teach that this should be the main source of your spiritual nourishment. This should just supplement what you're studying through the week and encourage you to go dive in the Scripture. Okay? I can explain grace to you, but you'll never experience it until you search it out yourself. Right? Does that make sense? All right, so I want to make sure, but grace has a purpose. Well, what is that purpose, Rob? Well, I'm glad you asked. Right? It's to display his great mercy and love. Look what Ephesians 2 says, Paul. This is the NASB. I'm covering all the versions of the Bible today, it seems like. So that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches, right, of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. Listen to me, ladies and gentlemen, look up here real quick. Come in close. See where I highlighted the word in? You want to experience those surpassing riches? It takes being in Christ. Well, what does that mean, Rob? That means right where you're at, you cry out to him and say, I surrender my life to you. I want that super soaker of grace, man, on me today. I want to marinate in your grace, God. I want to marinate in your grace in kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. But here's the really cool thing. Romans 5:8 says he did all this when we didn't even care about it. That he demonstrated his love when we were busy doing our own thing and happy being our own sovereign and our own king. He still sent his son to be crushed on the cross. That's kindness, would you agree? That's mercy, would you agree?
That's grace. Would you agree? Grace has a purpose in that God, right? Our justification is his glorification, in other words. He saves us through his mercy and his grace to bring himself glory, because that's what we were created. Here's the kicker. If you're a guest today, listen, if you've never heard this. When he saves you, it's not for yourself. It's not so I can get my fire insurance card. It's not so I can never do anything for the kingdom of God. Well, he saves you for this purpose, because the fulfillment and the joy that you're looking for in life is found when you glorify him through your life and in your life. True. Right? To display his great mercy and love. Right? Here's the thing. We're not put on display, because Paul goes on later, right? Some people use the Ephesians 2:10 is what it is, where one version says we are God's masterpiece, and then we turn it around and we make it man-centric and man-centered. No, we're his masterpiece, and we're his workmanship put on display to bring him glory. Not to bring our denomination glory, not to bring our church building glory, to bring him glory in everything because of what he has done. It shows the world that God can take broken, wicked, and depraved people and use them for his glory. In other words, none of us would have been picked first. You ever had that happen to you? Now, I'm a pretty buff guy, so I never had that happen to me. But, you know, have you ever had that happen for like a football team or basketball? Well, basketball I did, because I'm only like 5'5". My wife won't even give me the half. I like to say I'm 5'5 and a half. She's not here today, though, so 5'5 and a half, okay? I'm not going to dunk anytime soon unless there's a trampoline that I can bounce off, right? But here's the thing. I never got picked first for the basketball, right? They were like, even the little girl got picked first over there. Like, okay, we'll take you. Here's the thing. God's picking you first because of his grace. Because of his grace, right? Because of his grace, he loves us. I love what David Platt says in closing today. He says this. I'm going to put it on the screen. God blesses his people with extravagant grace so they might extend his extravagant glory to all the peoples on the earth. You are super soaked with grace today. Not for yourself, right? But to show his extravagant glory to all the people on the earth. Can I just be honest with you real quickly? And we'll read the Titus and then we'll close. Here's the good news of the gospel. Okay? God helps those that can't help themselves. Listen to me, because I see this on Facebook. I call it Facebook theology. Well, God doesn't help people that don't help themselves. That's not in the gospel anywhere. Because that's what grace is. Because Paul writes in Ephesians chapter 2, up above where we were reading, he says that we were dead in our trespasses. So how does someone spiritually dead help themselves apart from the supernatural work of grace? I'll tell you how. They can't. Right? The good news of the gospel is God, right, helps people that don't help themselves, right? See, here today, your life may be a mess. Mine was a mess 20 years ago. I was an addict. I was just messed up, man. I was in a really bad place. And I grew up in church my whole life. And I heard about grace a million times. And I went to VBS. And I was on the drama team. And I sang on the choir. And I did all these religious things. But what had happened is I never truly learned about grace and experienced grace in my life. And so what happened is when I fell into that mess, I ran from God instead of running into grace. Right? So today, here's what I want to say as we close, is that the good news of the gospel is if you can't help yourself today, God's grace will help you. He loves you. He's not waiting for you to get your act together. 20 years ago, through the death of a sibling, God sobered me up, and he reached me in a place that I could never be reached. I didn't want to help myself. And he saved me. If that's you today, right in your chair, I'm not going to call you up. We don't do that. We're not going to send 10 people over there to jump on you. Here's what I want you to do right now in your heart. Right now.
I can't give you the prayer to say, but I can tell you here's where I would start. I would say, here are the keys to the kingdom of this wicked heart. I'm laying my yes down to you today. Right where you're at. You just say that. Right where you're at. Okay? Because here's the thing. You can't fix it. You can't. I've tried. You can't. But he can. Isn't that good? He can. So if that's you right now, I just want to take a minute. Carlos is going to lead us in a little something. Right now, if that's you, if you don't know Christ today, or maybe you've been far away and you need to rededicate, recommit, whatever words you want to call it, that's not for me to say. But right where you're at, will you lead us, Carlos? Just lead us in a little something. And we're going to get ready for baptism here in just a few minutes. Come on, right in your chair, you call out to him. Say, I'm tired of trying to fix it. I can't fix it. I'm laying everything down to you, Jesus.
Blind, but now I see.
Come on, right where you're at.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Come on. Come on, I hear the sound of grace in this building this morning.
Me,
cry out to him.
Once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. My chains are gone. I've been set.
Come on, let him have those chains this morning.
My God, my Savior.
Here comes the flood of grace.
And like a flood, his mercy rains, unending love.
All right. Listen. Now let's talk to the believer. If you're a believer this morning, you say, Rob, I needed to be reminded of this today. I'm far away. I feel angry. I feel frustrated. I'm drowning in the midst of my frailty and my insecurities. Right now where you're at, Carlos is going to sing again. You just ask God to baptize you afresh in his grace today. Come on. I'm going to pray for a flood of grace today in this building, right? Lead us again, Carlos, would you?
My chains are gone.
Come on.
I've been set free.
Come on, here's my chains, God.
My God, my Savior has ransomed me.
Carlos, come on, church. Help us sing it. If you know what his grace is about, sing it today.
My chains are gone. I've been set free.
You can't do it yourself.
God, my Savior.
Yes, Lord.
Has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy.
Read you this passage of scripture. Titus 3:4-7 says, but when the kindness and the love of our Savior appeared, he saved us not because of righteous things we had done. You understand that? Not because of righteous things that we had done, but because of his mercy. He saved us through the washing of rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs and have hope of eternal life. Grace has a purpose. You're no longer an orphan today. You're an heir and a co-heir with Christ. Can we sing that again, Carlos? I'm going to ask Alex to get ready to be baptized here. We're going to sing, then we're going to come back and... Come on, sing it with us if you know it.
How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like
me. Come on, church.
I once was lost, but now I'm found.
Come on.
Was blind,
Don't let the sin be greater than the grace today. Let the grace be greater than the sin today. Come on.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Yes.
That saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found.
Come on, run into His grace. Run into His grace today. Here we come, Jesus.
My chains
come on, church.
Gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love.
Come on, let's do it again. My chains are gone. I'm free today. I'm free.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns, unending love.
Listen, we're going to transition today. I'm just going to speak to you one more time. If you want to be baptized, don't let anything stand in the way. Okay? Don't let anything stand in the way today. Listen, we don't believe baptism saves people, but we believe it's necessary and it's important because it was important to Jesus. Okay? Right? We believe it's important to Jesus. He followed through with baptism. We do as well. Okay? So we're getting ready to transition into that. Here's what I want to do real quickly. Please be seated. As we get ready for Alex and whoever else is going to be baptized, I'm going to ask Pastor Matt. Daniel, could you help us this morning too? Would you help us? Daniel's one of our elders. He's going to come and help us as well this morning. All right, make sure they come back out of the water. And, no, just kidding. Right? But let me say this as we close and we get ready to close, is we'll go ahead and do our baptism and we'll do our offering. If you have to leave for whatever reason, we understand. We don't want to hold you here, but we do want everyone to stay as possible because we want to celebrate this, right? This is a celebration because baptism is symbolizing that I've been buried with Christ. This is what Paul writes, that I'm buried with Him in baptism, and when I come out of the water, it's signifying that I'm raised, right, to a new life. That the old Rob or the old whoever is staying in there, and now I'm new. I'm proclaiming to the world, to my friends, I'm making a vow, if you will. I'm making an oath that when I come in and I come out, that I'm a different person, right? It's signifying externally what's happened, right, internally. Does that make sense? You with me? Okay. So whoever's going to be baptized, if you line up over here by Daniel or one of our elders, Carlos, will you sing that again for us as we get ready? We're going to pray.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy.
Amazing grace.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, His mercy reigns unending.
Just real quickly, after the baptism, we do our offering a little bit differently here. We have two brown boxes in our cafe area. This is mainly for our faith family and our regular attenders. But also, if you had a card and you're a guest, we would love for you to fill that out on your way out and drop it in that box. We'll put something on the screen in just a second, but just in case we ran out of time, I just wanted to say it now. So, Zach, Alex, ready? All right, you want to test it out for your uncle?
Woo!
Yeah. And we all said amen, right? Well, come on this side. Okay, well, we'll hurry up. Hurry up. Father, we just pray for Alex today, and I thank you for the young man that you are making him and growing him. And I thank you, God, for the purpose and the calling that you've given him, God. We just pray over him, and as they baptize him today, God, that he would understand that the old Alex is no longer anymore, but this is the new Alex for your glory. In Jesus' name. Go ahead, man. Can we get somebody to help him walk out? Can we get one of our dream teamers or leaders to help him? We got somebody coming. All right. All right. Can we get one of our people to get a mop too? It's right by in the cafe here. Get a mop so we can make sure that nobody slips. All right. Listen. This is Zach Light. Everybody say, what's up, Zach? Hey, it's your birthday. All right. Right, I've known Zach since he was a little. I call him Zacchaeus. Still, he still allows me to call him Zacchaeus, even though I know he probably talks about me behind my back when I do that. But listen, this guy right here is a world changer. I really believe that. He has it in him. I've always believed it, and I'm so proud of him today. And I know that God has big plans for him, his girlfriend, and his new family. Right, and God's going to do some big things. Father, we love you and we thank you for Zach today. So, Father, I just thank you, God, for the man of God that he is desiring to become, that you would continue to change him. Father, I pray that you would wreck his world, God, that he would not be completely satisfied in this life until he's totally 150% sold out for you. So, Father, we pray against any of the past, that it be broken in the name of Jesus, that those chains be gone. And we pray, God, for grace today. We thank you for your love today. And as we baptize Zach today, God, we're just proclaiming to the world that the new Zach is coming out. And that he's ready to change the world for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Zach, we got you a little blanket coming here. Give us just a second. Amen. Can we sing that again, Carlos? Come on.
My chains are gone.
Come on, church. Celebrate with them today.
I've been set free.
Come on.
My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy reigns.
Come on, one more time. Come on, scream it out today. Shout it out today. Your mercy, God. Your love today. Come on, church. A chain.
My chains are gone. I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me.
Like a flood.
Like a flood. His mercy reigns.
Offer it one more time. This cold water is calling your name, right? Don't let anything stand in your way. But seriously, if you want to know more about what it means to be saved, what myself, one of our leaders, would love to talk with you. Once again, we like to leave here celebrating, giving generously and sacrificially because he gave so much to us. Amen. So I'm going to pray over our time of offering. I'm going to pray to close our service. And I pray that you guys have a blessed day. Father, we love you. And God, I pray that as we sow into your kingdom, as we go out the door, that we celebrate your grace, that we celebrate your love, that we celebrate with Zach and Alex today, God, that they are dead to the old man and they are been raised anew, God, to walk with you, Jesus. So, Father, here's what I pray. I pray that you would use both of them to go after more people, God, to go after more lost people and hurting people, God, for your glory. So, Father, we give to your kingdom today, and would you use it in such a way that you would get all the credit and all the glory. We pray this in your son's name. Amen and amen. Have a blessed Sunday.
Mercy reigns unending.